either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently until she find it? Sweep the house clean.
Brothers and sisters, we lose things of value all the time. And losing things of value can happen quicker and easier than one would expect. For example, you could be walking to your car. You stick your hand in your pocket or in your pocketbook just to get your keys, and as you pull out your keys, something falls out of your pocket. Something falls out of your bag, and just like that, you lost it. You could be riding on a bus or a train, and when you get to your destination, you get off, and where you were sitting, you leave your umbrella. It happens all the time. Just that easy, you lost it. Think about it. At some point in all of our lives, we will all have to endure the experience of losing something valuable that we have. It's normal. We leave the house, we lose things outside. But it's when we start losing things inside the house that things get interesting. Now, I don't know about you, I'm just going to speak for myself, but when I lose something of value in my own house, I feel shame. I'm going to tell you. You see, it's my house. I ought to know where everything is in my house. I ought to know where I put my keys in my house. I ought to know where I put my wallet or put my money or put my watch in my house. But that's not how life is. Even in our own house, we lose things. You don't have to be a sloppy person. You don't have to be a dirty, unorganized person to lose something in your life. Let me get deeper. You don't even have to be a bad person. You don't have to be a person with a bad attitude to lose something in your house. And if I can get spiritual, you can be a Christian. You can be a born again believer, sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ, and still lose things of value in your house. But it's a shame, some of the things we lose in our own house. Now, everybody loses money in their house. Everybody loses socks. Things like that. But what do? When you're a man and you lost your wife in your house? What do? When you're a woman and you lost your mind and your husband in your house? What do? When you're a parent? And I'm not just talking about any kind of parent. I'm talking about a super parent. You know, the parent that attends all the PTA meetings. The parents that have the bumper stickers on their car, "My child is an honor student." The kind of parents that have family pictures all on the walls and they even post them on Facebook and Instagram. You know, super mom. Super dad. What do, super mom and super dad, when you lose your own children in your house? How does that happen? How do you lose something of such value in your own house? Now, I know most of us came to church today to hear a word of value.
All right now.
To find some more hope to go on a little longer. To hear a blessing, to find a promise from God. And then we'll take that and we'll try to run with that for the rest of the week. I know that's what we came here for. But church, God knows that deep down in some of your hearts, deep deep down in the back of some of your minds, you're really ashamed of the valuable things that you've left and lost in your house. We're good at putting on the brave face when we leave the house, as though we've never lost anything.
Come on now.
As though everything is together.
Come on.
As though we know where everything is in our house. Maybe that's why sometimes when we go to work, we don't want to be there. Sometimes when we go to church, we don't want to be there.
Come on now.
We can't even concentrate on the singing of Zion songs. We can't even concentrate on the word being preached. In the back of our mind and in our deep in our hearts, we're ashamed about what we've lost at home. We all lose things. In our text today, we read about a woman who lost something. The Bible doesn't tell us what her name is. We don't know how old she is. We don't know how long she had what she had. And the Bible does tell us that what she lost was a silver piece. Some translation says that it was a silver cord. And it didn't amount to much in terms of monetary value, but it was important to her. It was valuable to her. Sometimes you have something that you lose, and to the world, it's of no value. But to you, it's everything. It's that watch that your father, who's not here anymore, gave you. It's that thing, that beautiful thing that your grandmother bought with her hard-earned money. She gave it to you. She trusted you with it. And you lost it in the house. God trusts us with things. All he says is, I'm going to give it to you. And all I want you to do is take care of it. All I want you to do is cherish it. All I want you to do is take care of it. But we live in a society now where even church folk act like we don't really care about things. Can I talk to my friend? We live in a society that's much like the people that Jesus was talking to when he talked about this parable. Jesus was talking to the scribes and the Pharisees of his day. I say the scribes and the Pharisees of his day because if we look in the Bible, we'll never see a word that he wrote to us. We'll always see a word that he wrote to them, but it applies to us. We still have people who are Pharisees thinking today. We still have people who are scribes. What do I mean by that? It means that the way they value you is nothing. They want to look at you as though you're not even worth $3. But Jesus was talking to the Pharisees. He actually, in this chapter 15, he gave them three parables. The first parable, he talked about the shepherd who was watching 100 sheep. You know that one, and he lost one sheep. And instead of him chilling with the 99, he did what he had to do to find that lost one. And then the third one was when the father lost his son. That's the prodigal son. But we're going to talk about right now the second parable. The woman who lost that coin. Lord, Jesus knows that we all have coins that we lost. Your coin may not be the kind of coin that this woman lost. Maybe your coin is your faith. Maybe you lost your faith. Some man or woman's coin is her relationship with her husband. Women aren't the only ones that lose things. Men, we lose things too. Men, we lose things too. Sometimes we lose our nerve.
Come on now.
That's why we just stay in the house and watch football. That's why we lock ourselves in a house instead of being in the living room with the wife and the son and the children.
Come on now.
We run downstairs into the playroom. We try to make it look like everything is good. We know where everything is, but the truth is we love something. Am I talking to somebody? Jesus was talking to the Pharisees. They didn't even understand what he was trying to say to them. What he was saying is, I am here to bring a kingdom system, a kingdom value, and you are still stuck on a man system, a man value. So in other words, when I talk to you about one coin being lost, you want to concentrate on the nine that the woman still had. God wants to concentrate on the one that she lost. And you'll see in this parable that the woman swept the house. She searched it and she swept it. It says the woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. That coin was called a drachma back in the day. And it says that about 10 drachmas of the old world silver coins would be nearly about $2, not much. She had it, but she lost it. The Bible tells us that she tried to find it. I like this woman. Because nowhere in the text does it talk about her blaming somebody for losing her stuff. Nobody talked about in the text how she started blaming somebody for taking something that she had. She lost it, but she knew where it was. It was somewhere in the house. What do you know that's lost in your house, but you have not yet started searching for it for real? You didn't really start sweeping. The Bible says that she started sweeping. Oh my gosh. I feel the Holy Spirit right now getting ready to start sweeping through this place. Oh my gosh. She was a poor woman. Even though she lost only one of these coins, she could not afford to lose it. She was poor. She needed it. But the question here in the text for me is not that she was poor enough and couldn't afford to lose it. I'm impressed because she felt that she would do what she had to do to find it. She knew that the value of this coin was more to her than it was to anybody else in the world. Husband, don't let anybody talk down on your wife. Don't let anybody tell you that your children are not worth you doing what you have to do for you to take them to the next level. Women, don't let a woman that don't have a man tell you how to treat your own man. At least you're trying to find what you lost. She couldn't afford to lose it. But the real question isn't if she couldn't afford to lose it. The real question is whether or not she could afford to find it. Could she afford to find her lost coin? Because it costs you something to look for something. It costs you something to look for something. You have to put your pride on the ground when you start looking for something. You have to start picking up your faith. When you have to just say, listen, I don't care what they think. I got to find this thing. This is important to me. I have a dream. No one thinks that this dream is worthy of anything else. But God gave me this dream. I might have put it down 5 years ago, but I got to find it. It's in his house. I'm going to pick it back up. Our children have seemed to lose their zeal for many things. The sad part is they probably lost it in the house. When you and I were children, we used to have to leave the house to lose things. We didn't have the internet. We didn't have 800 channels on HBO and all that cable stuff. So for us to lose something of value, we usually had to leave the house. But now they have people that can come and steal their joy right on the internet. I'm not saying the internet is bad. But I'm saying that as a father, if I've lost my son, I don't even know who's stealing him while he's in his room. Amen? This woman was poor. But she counted the cost. Luke 14, 28 through 30 says that when we start trying to do something for the Lord, we have to count the cost. Hallelujah. Count the cost! She counted the cost before she started looking. And then it says that she lights a lamp and sweeps the house. That tells me some things. That tells me that her house was dark in the first place. It was dark in the first place. If you ever lived in a house where there's not much sunlight, you understand what I'm talking about. You lose something in the middle of the day, you still need to turn on a light to find it. She turned on the light, and then it says she swept the house diligently. That word diligently means she just didn't happenstance. She just didn't look on it. She was into it. She was standing up. She had her broom because she was sweeping while she was searching. She was sweeping while she was searching. That's what Jesus did. Every time he was searching for something, when everybody came up on him, he would sweep them. In other words, he would clean while he went. Yes. You know what it's like to clean while you go? It means that I'm not going to go over this part again. I'm searching for something that I lost. But guess what? I was looking for that 3 years ago. I found it. You start putting your life in order when you sweep while you search. Raise your hand if you know what it's like to look for something. You don't find it, but you find five other things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're looking for that relationship that you lost. But guess what you find while you're looking for it? You find the courage to keep going. Guess what you find while you're looking for that thing? You find out that you lost your prayer life and didn't even know it. Guess what happens when you start looking and searching and sweeping? You find out that the whole time it was lost, but you didn't even realize it. You didn't even know it. Husband, you didn't even realize that your wife hasn't really smiled in the house for 3 years. Wife, you didn't realize that your husband, the only time he comes home is after his money ran out. I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes. I'm just trying to say that it's shameful of things we lose in the house. So this woman lost it in the house. And she took responsibility for finding it. She didn't blame her mother. She didn't blame her baby daddy. She didn't blame her boss. She didn't blame the world or society. She just got to work and she started searching and sweeping. That's what we need to do here, even in the church. Don't blame the kids if they don't know what the scripture is. We need to search the scriptures for them. We need to help sweep with them. We need to show them how to fight this demon. When you sweep the house, sometimes it's not just dirt you're trying to sweep out. Sometimes it's not anything physical that stole your stuff. It's spiritual. You sweep the house. You sweep the house. You can't worry about how pretty you look while you're sweeping. I can imagine this woman took off her church clothes. She took off her work clothes. She took off her pretty stuff. And she said, nah, child, I got to put my bun up in my hair. I got to get this together. Yeah, and then she took off her good clothes. She said, I'm getting ready to put on my dirty clothes because I'm going to get ready to get down and I'm going to find this thing. Sometimes you got to get down and dirty when it's time for you to find that thing that you've been looking for. I know it's not coming to you. Sometimes we wish we could just call it. We say, where are you, coin? Where are you, lost thing? But guess what? That thing ain't going to talk back to you. If you want to talk to somebody, you need to talk to Jesus and ask him to help you find what you lost. talking about you and calling their best friends and saying, you know what that child did? She's always losing something, girl. She wants me to go over her house. I ain't going over her house. Every time I get there, the house is dirty anyway. She don't have no food. She ain't gonna do nothing for me. Don't worry about calling people to help you find your stuff. There are some things your friends can't help you with. There are some things that they should not know that you ever lost. Can we talk about this? We call ourselves Christians and we don't even know how to search or sweep.
Come on now.
We call ourselves Christians, child and daughters and sons of God. We don't know how to clean spiritually our own house. Couple of weeks ago, after service, Reverend Gibson, myself, Reverend McWilliams the Fourth, we went and was commissioned to do a cleaning spiritually in somebody's house.
Come on.
I gotta confess, I had not cleaned my own house before I went into that person's house.
Come on now. Come on.
Oh yeah, we prayed, but I had not said to the Lord, in the name of Jesus.
Come on.
I bind Satan, all of his demons, all of his evil spirits. In the name of Jesus, I bind you under the blood. I didn't clean my own house so that I would be effective in cleaning somebody else's house. Don't you talk about what's wrong in somebody else's life. And you don't even fix what's going on in your life. Sweep your own house. I don't get upset with our children anymore. We teach them how to sing songs. We teach them how to say a Bible scripture. But we don't teach them how to sweep the house. Just the other day I said, Vinnie, sit down. I want you to say this prayer right here. He thought it was going to be a regular prayer. When he started reading the words, I realized in his spirit, he was saying, what the? Because he was praying things like, Heavenly Father, please protect me in the name of Jesus Christ. Cover my house. Cover my siblings. Cover my parents from all evil, from all psychic thoughts, from all psychic deeds, from all hoodoo and voodoo, from all hexes and vexes. This I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. I realized, I said, I'm losing my son. He's lost in the house, but I didn't teach him how to sweep. He's lost in his own room. Our children are lost. And we're watching television. We're watching hip hop this. We're watching this girl, a real this, a real that. We're watching television, and the devil is stealing our children. And it's not anybody's fault, but the people who live in that house. Can I get deeper than that? This woman, I like this woman, because she searched, and she swept. Diligently. That means that if you are diligent about it, you've got to pray more than once a day. You've got to lift up more than one scripture. You've got to forgive more than one person every year. Diligently. Find this thing that you lost. We have church mothers who come out here every day. And you know they didn't teach you how to sweep. Mother Gordon, teach me how to sweep, honey. You've been here for so long and you know how to worship. The word says that he inhabits. What? Does he inhabit our praise? Is that what Sister Parker was doing? When she took that mic from the kid, she said, let's start sweeping. Let's start sweeping. And listen, I know this isn't for everybody. Because maybe everybody didn't lose something. I've lost things. I've lost years of relationships with my mother. Years of relationships with best friends. All because I blamed them for what I lost. But when Jesus got in my life, Lord Jesus, when he gave me the power to start praying in his name, when he gave me the power to start sweeping out my house in his name. But I tell you, God tells you to go into their house and help them sweep. Make sure you sweep your own house first. Make sure whoever's in the house, you walk over to them and you say, I think I lost you somewhere along the way. But I love you. You're still the person that I fell in love with. I'm still the person that you fell in love with. I'm sorry I lost you. Maybe you're the coin that the woman lost. But I tried enough. I found out that she wasn't the coin. My wife wasn't the lost coin. I was the lost coin. Raise your hand if you've been lost in your life. You know what it's like. And it's sad when nobody comes looking for you. But all we want is for someone to sweep for us. Clean it out. Help me find myself. And this is what the woman had to come to. She tried as hard as she could. She probably couldn't find it. She was getting tired. She was getting frustrated. She was losing faith. But she probably came to herself. Come to yourself. Like the prodigal son, the word says, he came to himself. You don't know you're lost until you come to yourself. And the moment you come to yourself, you will realize that where you started is not where you are. You started on your road to college. Now you don't even go to school. You started in the church. Now you don't even go to church. Come to yourself. Everyone in here needs to come to themselves. You need to understand that it's not about that man that doesn't treat you right. It's not about that he doesn't value you. You need to know that you are a kingdom citizen. You are kingdom property. And God gives you value according to the kingdom. That means that you will always be more valuable to God than you ever will be to man. Say that again. You'll always be more valuable to God than you ever will be to man. So what can you do? You'll stop complaining. You'll stop murmuring. You just put that thing on your head and you start getting ready. You say, while I'm searching, I'm sweeping. Lord, I'm going to find my faith. I'm going to find my joy. I'm going to find my way. And I'm not going to do it by myself. No, I'm not going to call a friend. I'm not going to call Oprah. I'm not going to call Dr. Phil. I'm going to call Jesus. He's going to help me search. He's going to help me sleep. And I guarantee you, it may take a year. It may take 5 years. It may take 30 years. But oh, I'm going to find this thing. I'm going to find it. I'm going to find it. And when you find it, do what the woman did. Throw a party. She threw a party. The word says that she rejoiced. She called up her girlfriends. She called up her friends. She called up her BFFs. She called up the neighbors. She said, I didn't need you to help me find it, but I need you to help me celebrate the fact that God